Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. We're going to start. I'm Tony Barber, the Europe editor of the Financial Times, and it's my pleasure to have as my guest this afternoon Yanis Stonaras, who is the governor of the Greek Central Bank and, of course, a former finance minister. I'm tempted to say that these two posts have given Mr. Stonaras a ringside seat at all the great events that have happened in Greece and the Eurozone in recent years. But of course, he wasn't, in fact, at the ringside. He was actually in the ring itself. And to extend the boxing metaphor, if I may, here he is today, and he's still standing after all these rounds. Some of those rounds more bruising than others. Even if he hasn't found it necessary to emulate Muhammad Ali in 1974 and use the rope-a-dope tactics, he certainly weathered the storm well, and I don't think we're yet at the 15th round. So, I propose to divide our session into roughly two parts. One, we'll survey current Greek economic conditions, and then we'll move forward and consider some other aspects of contemporary Greek public life. Now, I suspect, Mr. Stonaras, that our audience is interested, first of all, as regards the Greek economy, in two questions. And one is quite simply, how successfully is the Greek economy healing and recovering after the events of recent times? And secondly, what is the outlook for the next few years? What are the risks ahead? So please.
Thank you. You can say standing and kicking, actually, so the central bank governor. Well, I will start by the achievements, then I will go to the challenges, the risks, and the strategy for the future. I will go very quickly and very telegraphically so we can have time for questions. First of all, huge progress since the beginning of the crisis. Full elimination of very big twin deficits. They have become now surpluses, the current account and the budget. Perhaps the biggest adjustment ever in an OECD country. From 2009, that the crisis started, up to today. Second, full restoration of competitiveness, especially in terms of labor costs, but also in terms of prices, slightly less in terms of prices, mostly with regard to labor costs. Third, bold reforms, privatization, economic modernization program, labor in particular, and product markets, healthcare, social security systems, fiscal framework, tax system, and public administration. However, a serious backtracking, according to the World Bank indices. In the rule of law, the quality of governance and institutions, we are back in 2007. We have a diagram on page 147 in the governor's report that was issued few days ago. As a result of all these major reforms, the economy has become more extrovert, and the production model has become to rebalance towards export-oriented sectors. Finally, the restructuring and consolidation of the banking system. We have now a smaller banking system, but with a high common equity tier one, and a big coverage ratio, which enables the Greek banks to effectively manage their high NPLs, non-performing loans. However, the problem is that during the crisis, Greece lost over one-fourth of its GDP at constant prices. Unemployment rose by nearly 16 percentage points. GDP per capita in purchasing power parity in 2016 came to merely 68% of the European Union average, down from 93% in 2009. Meanwhile, and this is the most serious aspect of the crisis, a large brain drain has taken place, depriving Greece's society and economy of one of its productive parts, with devastating demographic, economic, and social consequences. Very quickly, challenges ahead. We have corrected the flow problems, deficits become surpluses, competitiveness has improved, but legacy problems. Public debt sustainability. We have a big public debt, so number one problem, this must become sustainable. So we expect our peers, the Eurogroup, to make as soon as possible and as clearly as possible decisions to make debt sustainable. Without this, we cannot go anywhere. Second, confidence, consolidation of confidence. We should not backtrack, nor in the short term, neither in the long term. Backtracking will be death. Third, smooth return to markets. Sine qua non for a smooth return to markets is the consolidation of confidence, is the public debt sustainability, but also a clever strategy to approach markets. The government has decided to build a cash buffer. The Bank of Greece, which is independent and does not take instructions, advises that we should not neglect a precautionary credit line because this can be able to bring down borrowing costs, can retain the waiver for the Greek banks. Finally, banks. The challenge is to reduce further the non-performing loans. We had a very good last quarter in 2017, where non-performing loans fell by more than 5 billion according to preliminary data. This is a very good start. What are the risks now and sources of uncertainty? Backtracking, I would put it as a number one risk. We should not allow backtracking. We should not allow the Greek political system to fall back into bad habits of the past. Second, a serious risk of a sustainable reversal of Greek government bond yields. After a very good 2017, where yields fell a lot, in 2018 we witnessed a reversal. Yesterday, the 10-year Greek government bond yield was at almost 4.5%, compared with 1.9% for Portugal and Italy. So the risk to the debt dynamics is too clear. Of course, there are also external risks. There are elections in Italy tomorrow. We don't know what the result will be. Also, negotiations for Brexit, the refugee crisis, problems in the Korean Peninsula with Iran. So we should be vigilant. Finally, what is the strategy for sustainable growth in Greece? Greece, first of all, needs political normality. Would not need a toxic political developments. We need consensus because this is not the end of the road. This is the beginning of a new era, and we need social and political consensus. The problem is a huge investment gap, so we need to attract foreign direct investment because domestic savings are not enough to cover an investment gap of the order of 12% of GDP every year. And in order to do that, I think first we need a drastic overhaul of public administration with clear delimitation of state intervention in private initiatives. We need to make extensive use of public-private partnerships in a wide range of administrative procedures and in the delivery of public services, which would shift costs from taxpayers onto users, while at the same time enabling care to be taken to support the weakened groups of the population. Second, we need to speed up the privatization program and the development, especially the development of public property, which can attract foreign direct investment. And this can be done through a proper land use legislation. The Greek state is a big landlord, and has not yet been able to exploit this opportunity. Third, we need a stable tax system with lower tax rates and social contribution rates so that we can broaden the tax base. Fourth, we need to expand the use of electronic transactions to all types of economic activity so as to effectively reduce the informal economy and increase further the public revenue. Fifth, we should give a lot of emphasis to the so-called triangle of knowledge, that is education, research and innovation, with evaluation of higher education and linking research to funding and the production process. This is because linking higher education with the production process promotes innovation and the country's competitive advantages. Finally, sixth and much more important, operational independence of key institutions and the rule of law. For this to become possible, society and the political forces must understand that strong and sound inclusive institutions which do not serve the interests of specific groups at the expense of others promote the welfare of society as a whole. For the restart of the economy to be a success, the status of institutions, which is synonymous of confidence, needs to be elevated. Weak and closed institutions generate uncertainty and disorientation, where strong, open, and socially accepted institutions are necessary for a return to normality. Thank you.
Less than 10 minutes. yes, I expected no less. Let's have a look at a couple of things you touched on in those remarks regarding what framework for the post-third programme Greece, after next August, will be in place. Now, you mentioned the need for a financial safety net, and we know also there will be some kind of surveillance framework applied by the Eurozone for Greece. But this has become tangled up with the question of the recovery of national sovereignty, so to speak. This is a term that one hears in the political arena and in public discussion, that after 8 years, finally, sovereignty will be back. Do you think that there is any contradiction between having this financial safety net and the surveillance framework and the sense of a recovered national sovereignty?
Not really. Because voluntarily we have surrendered parts of sovereignty to the center of the Eurozone and the central bank for quite a number of years now. And also according to the regulations for program countries, there will be strict monitoring of developments until they pay back 75% of their debt. So there are a number of years that there will be strong monitoring of fiscal and structural developments. But I do not consider it as a problem. I think we have learned lessons from the crisis, and I do not expect any backtracking.
What about this question of the long-term fiscal surpluses that are being imagined for the future? I mean, is that something that might become hostage to politics as well?
The 3.5% surplus that we have up to 2022 is a high number. Very few countries have achieved that for a number of years. I think it would be ideal if there would be a trade-off having less of a primary surplus. Ideally, we could go down to 2% of GDP, and the difference and the fiscal space created be used to bring down taxes and social security contributions. And the difference, in nominal terms, could be offered by another privatization program. I said before that the Greek state is one of the biggest landlords as a percent of GDP in the OECD. So with proper land use legislation and an ownership of this idea, we could exchange less austerity for more privatization and structural reform.
So your recommendation there would be to get a move on with the privatization program, yeah?
Yes.
Now, nobody's talking at the moment about a severe change in the relatively benign global economic conditions that we see at the moment. But we all know that at some point the tide will turn, even if we can't be sure when. When it does, to what extent might that affect Greece's economic and fiscal stability?
Greek public debt dynamics are very sensitive to the interest rate developments. So any change, any negative change in interest rates, I mean, any increase in yields will affect Greek public debt. That's why I'm keen to see a substantial debt relief by our partners in terms of extension of maturities for interest payments and amortization, and also with enough clarity. If we add a lot of ifs and buts, then the message will not be clear. Markets will not take it well, and also do not forget we need both the IMF and the ECB to also say that debt is sustainable. It's not enough for the Eurogroup to decide a number of measures. We must also convince the IMF and the ECB, and the ECB's governing council, that debt is sustainable. And of course, any reversal in yields will mean perhaps more efforts to stabilize debt.
Now, this is not the first time that you've made a plea in public for measures from Greece's Eurozone partners for debt relief measures. You spoke at the annual meeting of the Bank of Greece and made the same point just recently. What is the realistic time frame for getting some measures like that approved? Could it be done within the space of this year?
Ideally, yes. I think they are long overdue now. Don't forget that the first instance where the Eurogroup had promised debt relief was November 2012. Since then, the conditions for that have been achieved in 2014, but the Eurogroup at that time did not give us some kind of debt relief. So I hope that they will do it now. Will be sufficient and with clarity.
Governor Stonaris, I'd like now, if we can, to turn to some of the other issues that have brought you into the public eye in Greece, and it's caught the attention, I may say, of people in the business and political and investment community internationally as well. And this relates to the allegations that have been made against you, your wife, and her company, if I'm correct, starting in 2015, but acquiring more intensity in recent weeks and months. Now, you made a statement to Parliament just the other day in which you categorically rejected these allegations, but could you elaborate and explain exactly what it is about them that you regard as baseless, and what the damage in your eyes is to the image of the country, the central bank, from this?
As you said, this has started many years before. The most recent incidents related to the so-called Novartis case, I'm accused of getting a bribery through a handbag of €1 million in order to make a tax settlement against the arrears of Novartis. So my question was, when did this happen? Do you have any evidence? Have I signed? Minister decisions are public. Has anybody seen my signature that I have settled the tax obligations of Novartis against the arrears of the government? So I'm pleading now for more than 3 weeks for somebody to show me my decision or anybody else's decision that that we have settled the obligations of Novartis against the arrears of the government. This is totally false. This is terrible for the country to accuse two prime ministers and eight ministers without any evidence at all. In the parliament, when we testified, the 10 accused, I haven't seen such a thing before in any parliament of the world to demolish completely these allegations. Completely. There's no accusations. It's all lies. Lies addressed to us by three witnesses, unknown, hooded. I'm really sorry. I'm really sorry for this country.
Yes, these are the so-called protected witnesses. Is that right?
I'm not sure how protected they have been. I do not know their incentives. They could have been blackmailed. I don't know what exactly the incentives have been for these people to say such lies.
You made the point in your statement to Parliament that just briefly before making your appearance, you had asked yourself, should you resign in order to avoid giving the impression that you were using the office of central bank governor to somehow shield yourself against judicial inquiries. But you told Parliament, actually, I immediately decided not to resign because that would have compromised the principle of central bank independence, which of course lies at the heart of Eurozone governance and indeed at the heart of the EU treaty. So let's consider this question of central bank independence. I mean, in one sense, Greece is not the only country where there have been questions laid at various times since the start of the euro. But how serious a threat is it, in your view, right now, this current climate?
It is very serious. For instance, if an unknown witness go to the head of the management of the Financial Times and say, Tony Barber has got $1 million in a handbag, will you resign? In the same way, I said there's going to be no compromise of the independence of the central bank and its governor. If the aim is is a compromise of the central bank and its governor, they have made a mistake.
It's said, of course, that by some people at least, this is just part of the natural to and fro of politics, that in a pre-election period this is the kind of thing that happens and it shouldn't be taken literally or too seriously. But presumably you would say that this is no light-hearted matter.
No, this is very serious. To accuse two prime ministers and eight ministers of the previous government with such lies, it is really a problem with the rule of law. I told you one example before. Before they sent it to Parliament, the prosecutor could ask, okay, let's see, has Mr. Stournaras signed anything regarding Novartis? Has Mr. Stournaras made any settlement? Just one simple example. I can give you 10, but this simplest one. For 3 weeks now, I say, okay, show me where is my signature, where I have settled the obligations on Novartis. against the obligations of the government towards the pharmaceutical industry. This is very simple. I mean, okay, somebody could be accused of something, of having done something, but in this case, there is nothing at all. These things have not happened.
Now, in searching for a motive for these accusations, you've said once, more than once, that you think it may not be a coincidence that the pressure on you intensified at the moment when you, as central bank governor, took decisions regarding the makeup of the board of directors of two Greek banks. Is this? Do you think the primary explanation?
Well, that's in 2016, when on a day that the Bank of Greece was to change the board of governors of a bank, tax police invaded my wife's offices. They found nothing since then. Okay, they have not returned the files yet. It was an illegal investigation. There was not a proper public order on that. No, there was no decision of the responsible head of the tax office. This is not rule of law. Sorry. And of course, the Bank of Greece proceeded with the change in the board of directors of that bank that day.
To be clear, which bank are we talking about now?
Well, it was an LSI, a less systemic bank.
Now, just to broaden this out a bit, you made the point in your introductory remarks this afternoon that one of the essential components of the reform process in coming years had to be the affirmation of independence of certain public institutions, an affirmation of the rule of law. And this is, of course, something that has preoccupied Greece's creditors and the international investment community as well for quite some time, arguably even predating the crisis that blew up in 2009-10. Your situation aside, is there an area, or are there some areas where one could say there has been some improvement, or is it bleaker than that? And the World Bank assessment that you referred to at the beginning tells a different story.
As you know, there's now a huge literature in economics which says that the most important source of growth and productivity is the independence of institutions and trust and the rule of law. I was surprised to see that despite the progress that we have made in the fiscal situation, in product markets, in the labor market, we have backtracked so seriously in the rule of governance, in the quality of institutions, and the rule of law. Now details could be found, but the fact is that without independent institutions, we cannot restore trust to the Greek society.
Would you include the tax administration in that list of independent institutions? And if you were to include it, would you say that is one area of public life that some improvements have been seen?
There has been an improvement in tax administration, which actually started in the government that I participated. We established an independent tax authority, and since then there is huge progress. There is tax collection. We don't have a collection problem now because the decisions to collect taxes are not with the political system, not with the finance minister. The decision is within the hands of an independent tax authority. And there has been substantial progress over there.
I'd like, if I may, for you to sort of put on your hat as someone who sits on the ECB Governing Council and takes a broad view of the of European economic conditions as a whole, and indeed this point about independence of institutions around the whole of Europe, or one might even say the democratic world in general. I mean, these are under strain, aren't they? I mean, Greece is far from the only country where one sees pressure on the independence of public institutions. Why? What explains this? I mean, one could even point to upheavals that have happened in countries that have been democracies for several centuries. We can see it in places that are where it's more recent. But everywhere there seems to be an unusual degree of pressure right now.
I think one of the big gains in the Western world is the establishment of independence of central banks. And not for strict technocratic reasons, not following, rules, constant rules of monetary policy, but mostly because central banks can take a long-term view and distance themselves from the political cycle. I think that was the big gain. We should not jeopardize these gains. We need independent central banks in the world.
I'm sure a lot of people in the audience would strongly endorse that view. One does hear a counter view, if you like, that one of the shocks that European public opinion endured after the 2008 crisis was that some of these institutions that were meant to protect the public against very severe economic shocks, such as independent central banks, such as technocratically efficient regulators, and so on, that this just proved not to be adequate to the tasks that faced them, or that they didn't see this emergency coming, and that dealt a real blow to the credibility of some of these independent institutions. So, despite your argument that one of the virtues of an independent central bank is that it is detached from the political cycle, there was this question mark over, well, how did we end up in this real emergency about a decade ago?
To be practical and specific, let's start with the crisis which erupted in the United States and came into the Lehman Brothers problem. What was the cause of it? The cause of it was the eradication of the post-war legislation which had separated investment banking from commercial banking. I think that was the source of the problem. So it was a mistake. It was a mistake to assume that markets take self-disciplined measures was a mistake. So we need regulation. For instance, since that crisis, central banks and regulators have forced commercial banks to increase capital a lot by more than 6 or 7 percentage points of risk-weighted assets. Also, we have taken measures. We have now Basel II, Basel III regulation. We have taken macroprudential measures. Okay, capitalism does not say develop in a linear way, nor do we have perfect foresight. We learn from our mistakes. I do not claim that there will be no crisis again in the future, but at least we are learning from past mistakes and take corrective action. But taking a political decision to backtrack on the independence of the regulators and central banks, or trying to shut their mouth, would be a huge mistake.
Should there be a future crisis in the Eurozone, do you believe that the area's defensive buffers, the defensive instruments, are strong enough now to withstand such a crisis?
Not yet. There has been progress. There has been tremendous progress, starting with the Greek crisis and all the measures taken. Greece is in the euro. We made it. There's no Grexit problem anymore, but we are still a long way to go. We have not completed the banking union. We have not completed the capital markets union. We need deposit insurance schemes. And to be fair, at the same time, we need risk reduction and risk sharing. We need risk sharing, but also sharing of responsibilities. I'm happier now that I see some kind of dialogue between Germany and France towards this aim. Because if we do not come to the end, then I'm afraid the euro will be subject to big risks in the future.
Does that imply there is a finite window of opportunity for these extra reforms? Are we talking about a couple of years or less even?
Yes, of course. First of all, we should take action that do not need changes in the treaty, because we are still, I'm afraid, under populistic pressure in many Eurozone or European Union countries, and you know very well what I mean. So we should start with light changes, like light, well, in quotation marks, like banking union, like capital markets union, like enabling the European stability mechanism to become something like the European Monetary Fund. But then we should also proceed with necessary treaty changes to provide more stability and more integrity of the Eurozone.
And are we going to see you in your current seat in the Bank of Greece's headquarters as governor throughout this possible period of change ahead?
Well, my mandate ends in July 2020, and I plan to honour this mandate.
Well, we'll look forward maybe to meeting again in Delphi in, say, 2.5 or 3 years' time and see how things have turned out. It should be fascinating. I'd like the audience to thank Yanis Tounaris for talking to us today.